Thank you very much. My talk probably will go to indeed to some kind of different direction from most of the talk, because instead of like explaining how to develop this great structure rising in symplectic topology, I want to put some limitation on this. So. Symplectic structure is a symplectic manifold, is a manifold locally modeled on this flat symplectic space. And contact structure is a odd dimensional analog of this, or you can say projective analog of symplectic structure. It's a hyperplane field which locally modeled on the plane field given by this Pfeiffian equation. So according to Darboux theorem, symplectic manifold is manifold which is or contact manifold made of this local charts, but it's the same as according to Darboux theorem, that it's a manifold, so you have some two-dimensional manifold with this closed maximal rank to form, and similarly contact manifold, it's a 2n minus dimensional manifold with a completely non-integrable plane field, where the complete non-integrability means that it's locally, according to Frobenius condition, is defined by one form, or globally this is one form with twisted coefficient, such that d alpha restricted to xi is symplectic. So it's at first glance they kind of look as completely different structure, but in fact it's almost kind of the same thing. It's just right odd dimensional analog of symplectic structure, and just you can see it from the following construction, that you have a symplectic manifold. And on symplectic manifold, you have what is called Liouville vector field. It's a vector field such that Lie derivative of omega is equal to omega. Or equivalently, you can say that if you take this interior product of z and omega, you get form alpha, which is a primitive of symplectic form. So then in this case, if you have a trajectory of this vector field z, then you have a one-dimensional filiation with transverse contact structure, because this plane field alpha equal to zero is a plane field which is, so suppose this say alpha yes, so the z is a non-vanishing vector field, so alpha also non-vanishing, so this plane field is tangent to this trajectories of z, and on any transversal slice you get contact structure, and it's invariant under this monodromy. And in case when space of leaves of z is some, say, Hausdorff space, then on the quotient is a symplectic manifold, is a contact manifold. And conversely, starting from every y and this contact structure, you can get this corresponding symplectic manifold, which is called the symplectization, which say in the case when the contact structure is co-orientable, this symplectic manifold is just r cross y, and this vector field z is just vector field d of ds, where this coordinate in this factor. So in the main object to study in symplectic manifold is a Lagrangian submanifold. And Lagrangian submanifold are kind of n-dimensional submanifold which are isotropic for symplectic form. And there is in my view, this main importance of Lagrangian manifold come from the fact that they have this two incarnations. So one incarnation of Lagrangian submanifold is in the can be provided by this example when you have a manifold which is a cotangent bundle of some manifold M, and you take a if you take a graph of differential of some function, so you take a, some standard coordinate, say PQ, in cotangent bundle, and you take a standard this PDQ form and symplectic structure T of PDQ, then the graph of differential of function is automatically Lagrangian submanifold, or more generally, graph of any closed form is Lagrangian submanifold. And conversely, if you have a Lagrangian submanifold, you can think about this, well, in the so-called exact case, meaning when you have a PDQ restricted to L is equal, PDQ restricted to L is exact, then this can be viewed as a graph of so-called front or multivalued function. So this is a just one interpretation. So from this point of view, this Lagrangian intersection theory becoming generalization of Moore theory, it's something about critical point, predictable point of function. And the second major example, when you take a product of two symplectic manifold and you take a form omega plus minus omega, then for every graph of some diffeomorphism, so if you take a graph of this diffeomorphism, then this graph is Lagrangian if and only if f is a symplectomorphism. So this is a big part of symplectic topology is coming from interplay between these two characterization. So in contact case, so as I said, that contact manifold you can view as this symplectic manifold with this Liouville field, and contact geometry can be viewed as just symplectic geometry equivariant or invariant with respect to this action by this Liouville flow, which expands symplectic form, and hence kind of analog of, like, if you take a Lagrangian manifold which is a tangent to this Liouville vector field, then it projects to contact manifold as a some n minus one dimensional submanifold, which is called Legendrian. And Legendrian submanifold play in contact geometry similar role as Lagrangian in symplectic geometry, and they are maximal integral submanifold of this non-integrable plane field.
Actually, called
Liouville
vector field. I think it's
Liouville
vector field.
It's the
one which expands.
Yeah, Liouville vector field is a it
satisfies. I thought it's one which expands.
Yeah. So it satisfies this equation, and so therefore, if you take a zt star of omega is e to the t omega. Yeah, but contact form is a this form alpha also expanded primitive by this field, and therefore kernel of alpha is preserved, and that's what it is. So what is the, if you kind of approach symplectic topology with kind of topological mind, so you immediately see just a lot of similarity of like all symplectic problem with topological problem. So because and also in contact geometry, because this symplectic form has an extremely huge group of automorphisms. You have a, unlike Riemannian case, so in some sense you can say, okay, so this is a just generalization of Riemannian geometry from, maybe not generalization, some kind of cousin of Riemannian geometry, where you replace symmetric form by skew-symmetric form, and hence you would think that this symplectomorphism or symplectic diffeomorphism which preserves symplectic form should be something like isometries. And indeed, you see, if you write this equation for preserving Riemannian metric, you have to write n times n plus 1 over 2 differential equation, and preserving symplectic form, you write n minus n minus 2 over 2 over equation with respect to n function. So it's fantastically both of them are determined. But still this like n difference between this thing make drastic difference. So in this case, the group of automorphism is extremely rigid, and in this case, it's becoming infinidimensional.
But only because the form is closed. The form is not closed.
Yes, but even if you have a, in Riemannian case, you have a flat metric, still, not, doesn't help.
Yeah, because closed two forms is the same as one form, and
yeah,
the
same number of variables. Yeah, okay. In any case, so it has this huge group of diffeomorphism. Okay, let me not to go into this. Most people here know this. And hence, it's kind of in the same in the contact case. So for instance, group of diffeomorphism X transitively on any, say, finite set of point on much more things. So really extremely huge group. So therefore, like handling symplectic manifold looks very much as a some kind of topological problem. So for instance, let's consider in this context problem of, say, existence or extensions of symplectic in contact structure. So suppose, say, you have some manifold and you want to, on this manifold, construct a symplectic structure. So you want to construct closed non-degenerate two form, and of course, like immediately necessary condition, you said, okay, so it have to have at least non-degenerate form, which not necessarily closed. So you take a non-degenerate form, and existence of non-degenerate form is the same as just a reduction of tangent bundle, group of tangent bundle to symplectic group, which is a homotopy equivalent to unitary group, and therefore this is the same as a construction from homotopical point of view, construction of almost complex structure on the manifold. So it's a kind of topological condition. And now you're asking, okay, so you get it, and is this sufficient or not? So well, you say, well, it's not quite sufficient because, say, well, at least if it's sufficient or not. And then Gromov proved that indeed, if X is open, then Gromov theorem says that this eta is homotopic to really symplectic form in the class of non-degenerate form. So there is no more abstraction for constructing of this symplectic structure on open manifold. What is called almost symplectic structure, I will refer to this. And similarly, that holds in the contact case. So if you take a contact manifold, and you want to, on contact manifold, consider almost contact structure. What is almost contact structure? Almost contact structure means that I decouple. So as I said, what is the contact condition? Well, again, let's restrict to co-orientable case. It means that you have one form, and you have a d alpha, and d alpha restricted to alpha equal to 0 is non-degenerate. So it's kind of differential condition. But now you decouple this condition, so you just, instead of d alpha, you just take a eta, which is any two form, and you say, well, let's call almost contact structure this pair, alpha eta, where eta restricted to alpha equal to 0 is symplectic, non-degenerate, which is again just mean, and this is given up to conformal factor, and hence this is just equivalent to having hyperplane field together with structure of symplectic bundle, or the same as a hyperplane field from a topical point of view with complex structure on this bundle, and this is called in topology stable almost complex structures. There's almost complex structure on the manifold cross R. So we have this. So Gromov theorem says that in this case, indeed, also you have almost contact structure, and the manifold is open. You can deform it to contact structure. So then you can say, okay, so let's just continue and let's analyze. Oh, moreover, Gromov proved here the same thing hold in parametric case. So suppose you have, two-form symplectic and they homotopic as just almost symplectic forms, and they are homotopic as symplectic as well on open manifold. So we can ask, okay, if the same thing holds in the closed case. And in order to get into the closed case, you need to solve extension problem, right? So you, for instance, you take a closed manifold, you remove one point, and then you can apply Gromov theorem, the complement of one point, and what is left, just you have this ball, and you have this structure near the boundary of this ball, contact or symplectic, and you want to extend this structure. So you can kind of try to do that, and kind of it turns out to be extremely difficult, but in some turn in the contact case is not as difficult as in symplectic one. So I'll come to this question a little bit later. So we have this question, so whether kind of given a germ of contact structure near, symplectic structure. Given germ of symplectic structure near boundary of two-dimensional ball, and which is extended to be as an almost symplectic structure. So is it possible, is there a symplectic extension?
Excuse me, is the same Gromov theorem for complex structures, not
yet? No, for complex structure, not true. So for complex, so this is of course would be wonderful, but for open manifold situation, kind of there is a drastic gap. So Gromov theorem holds up to codimension n plus 1. So we know that up to dimension n plus 1 into n. So this is a Gromov-Land-Weber theorem, which says that like if you're trying to extend that up to n plus 1 skeleton, you can do that in complex case. And it's known that you cannot extend it to top cell. And between n plus 1 and 2n minus 1, it's completely open question. Okay, but in this symplectic context, you still have almost just one last step left. So you have the symplectic extension, and immediately you say, well, of course, it's not true. Because in this case, if you have this form, symplectic form near the boundary, then the symplectic form near the boundary remember volume of the symplectic form if you manage to extend it. Because by Stokes' theorem, this omega near the boundary, you can write it, is equal d lambda, and then integral of lambda, which omega n minus 1 over the boundary, is equal to integral of omega n over the ball. And so therefore, if there is a symplectic extension, it has to be positive. So you have some one extra volume abstraction here, which in the case of closed manifold translate to condition that this manifold have to have some two-form whose power is non-trivial cohomology class, the fundamental class of the manifold. So anyway, you have this condition, but okay, you modify this question by this extra condition that you have this, and you ask, is it possible to extend or not? Well, and we know that it's not possible, and I'll explain it just in a few minutes. So, and you can ask similar question in contact case. You have an almost contact structure, and you have a contact structure which is extended, and you're asking, is it possible to extend it? Is extended as almost contact structure? Is it possible to extend it as a contact structure? And then you can ask the same question parametrically. You have a two contact structure, and they relative boundary homotopic as almost contact structure. Are they homotopic or not? And what is the kind of additional price here in this case would be if you could prove such theorem, that because of this Gray-Moser argument, this homotopy fixed on the boundary is in fact an isotopy. So you would prove uniqueness of structure up to isotopy. So, so there is this, like in the 60s, 70s, there were no symplectic topology yet, and kind of these questions very much were open. And was, for instance, I thought up some point up to about 72, I thought that this is actually all the answer to all these questions, for instance, should be positive. And so that would mean that there is no symplectic topology. So by the way, it's very easy to deduce that if both the statement, zero parametric and one parametric for symplectic or contact is true, then you can prove that the group of, say, symplectic diffeomorphism is its C0 closure is a group of all volume preserving diffeomorphism, and C0 closure of group of the group of contact diffeomorphism is C0 closure group of all diffeomorphism. And this would immediately show that, well, there is nothing like Arnold conjecture could be true because this fixed point is C0 property, and then like the old symplectic topology would disappear. And so therefore, as I say, these two properties cannot hold simultaneously, zero-dimensional and one-dimensional H principle. So I'll come to this in a second. So then in 80s, this symplectic topology was discovered, and kind of there was a lot of work of many people, but kind of culminated in the work of Gromov when he introduced this method of holomorphic curves. And so Gromov's idea was that, well, so as I said, so there exists this topology, and there exists this symplectic topology inside. And as I said, like all this thing saying that the symplectic topology is a topology, it's really not much difference between this thing. But on the other hand, inside the symplectic topology, there is also algebraic geometry, because there is an important and very prominent class of, say, symplectic manifold, which is provided by Keller manifold. And in Keller structure, it's kind of much more rigid, and you can prove a lot of result in Keller geometry, and kind of you would like to say, okay, so can we do something here? And one of the important tools in Keller manifold is understanding moduli spaces of holomorphic curve, and that was the idea of Gromov. So at that time was already Donaldson discovered this kind of how fantastically you can apply elliptic PDE in topology, and Gromov wanted to do the same thing in the symplectic case. And so he was looking at the proper equation, and he just thought, okay, well, you cannot have symplectic manifold is not Keller manifold, but it's almost Keller. So you can, if you have a symplectic manifold, you can always introduce almost complex structure on this manifold such that this thing becoming not integrable, but Keller. You have a Keller form in its ending, so you have a Hermitian metric invariant with respect to J, and its imaginary part is our symplectic form. And moreover, there is a homotopically unique choice, is a contractible space of such J, and so now if you can, in this situation, we can write some good equations, and out of this, you can, by the Donaldson scheme, you can extract invariants. And he very much succeeded in this program, and the point is that locally, almost complex manifold in with respect to theory of holomorphic curve behave the same way as a integrable holomorphic curve in integrable complex structure, and this existence of this so-called taming symplectic form provides some compactness property, which allows you to talk about this moduli spaces of holomorphic curve in symplectic manifold. And that started the whole this fantastic development last 25 years with Gromov-Witt invariant and Foucault category and kind of connection with mirror symmetry and kind of many Hofer metric and kind of a lot of great development in this thing. So, but my talk is not about this, but about kind of limitations of this. So, all this time, there were kind of some questions which still, despite all this progress, remain like basic question, for instance, like the one which I remain unsolved. And also, for instance, the following question many people tried to answer and somehow kind of was clear that theory of holomorphic curve doesn't quite work there. So what one of this great result with Gromov proof is application of his method of holomorphic curve is his famous non-squeezing theorem. And this non-squeezing theorem in particular said that if you take a polydisk, and let me denote this polydisk some kind of, so it's a polydisk in CN, and this is just radii of the corresponding disk, and I say let me order them in increasing order. And suppose you have a two such polydisk, and you are asking when one polydisk can be symplectically embedded to another polydisk. And of course, there exists a volume abstraction, which we just said that product of this R1, Rn is less than product of this radii. And Gromov proved that in addition, you should have the smallest radius of this one is less or equal than this one. So it was a Gromov theorem. And of course, there was a lot of effort to try to understand, is there any other abstraction? So like in dimension 2, not much beyond this, but let's suppose, is there any kind of intermediate abstraction for this embedding? And kind of like nothing worked, essentially. And people kind of were trying to find some maybe intermediate equation, some for not in for curve, but for something high dimensional, but kind of nothing worked. And until Larry Guth proved that in fact there is no other abstraction, at least modulo some constant. So there is some slight room left for extra invariant. But what he proved that there exists such some constant C, such that if the say R1 is less or equal than C, R1 less or equal than CR1, and the product R1 Rn is less or equal than CR1 Rn, then there is a symplectic embedding in this case. So, well, there is some subtle issue about this size of this constant, and there are some bounds for this, but this is already shows that you cannot go too far. So this is for me, this is a first example showing this limitation and saying that there is a kind of like where holomorphic curve is not applicable and nobody invented any way of using holomorphic curve for kind of getting high invariant, and that maybe they don't exist. And so therefore, from that point, I kind of started to take seriously this principle. So let's just say this kind of general principle that there is no symplectic life beyond holomorphic curve. So that's essentially kind of everything which is not in symplectic topology, not prohibited by the theory of holomorphic curve, is in fact possible. And this is, of course, kind of very vague principle because this holomorphic curve can be applied and were applied in very kind of many ingenious ways. And so it's not clear what it means, but at least there is in some cases strong feeling that like there is nothing like holomorphic curve exists and can be applied, and therefore it should be true. So let me start kind of my next example discussing this problem of existence of an homotopy of structure which I mentioned. Okay, so no, it's a long. Okay, sorry. Okay, so so let's start with this problem of extension of symplectic structure. So I said that this problem of extension of symplectic structure, is there any extra kind of invariance not coming directly from topology? So it was a, I think it's not published anywhere, but it follows immediately from Gromov non-squeezing theorem that indeed should be some additional abstraction, namely to extension of symplectic structure. So let me kind of explain how it goes. So let's consider the following example. So let's take a two-poly disk. One thin polydisk of big volume, and another kind of thick polydisk, but of small volume. So volume of this is less than this, but this is kind of thick, and Gromov theorem does not allow us to embed this one into this one symplectically. So you can kind of position them in the R2n, everything is here in R2n, and I can position them in such a way that they share a piece of common boundary. And then I take this piece of common boundary and I remove it. And then I get a piecewise smooth immersed sphere, kind of difference of this two-poly disk. So you can extend this to immersion, or maybe piecewise smooth, but even smooth. You can smooth it doesn't matter that it's piecewise smooth. And you get some spherical annulus immersed, and you can take an induced symplectic structure. So asking, is it possible to take this symplectic structure, and is it extendable to the ball, this one? So again, there is a volume, is precisely formal volume, which I wrote this abstraction somewhere. This one is precisely difference of volume of this polydisk, so it's positive. And also, it is a regular homotopic to the standard immersion, so there is no problem with kind of extension as a formally. So question, can you extend it? So I claim no. Why? Because, well, suppose you can extend it, and then now you can return back this our polydisk which you removed. So that means how it looks like. So you take this is our abstract disk with this induced structure, and then I added on outside this polydisk which I removed. And now I get some symplectic manifold, which near the boundary is exactly coincide with our thin polydisk. So you have a thin polydisk, and inside you have a thick polydisk. And of course, this thin polydisk does not have a standard symplectic structure, but it doesn't matter because Gromov methods perfectly work for this. You can sweep this by family of this holomorphic disk, and you can find holomorphic disk through the center of this ball, and which says that this ball have to have radius smaller than the smallest radius of this one. So in symplectic case, there is no this kind of H principle type claim for extension is not true. Remember, I said that the symplectic rigidity kind of result proven in the 80s, in particular, implied that the group of symplectic diffeomorphism is C0 closed in the group of all diffeomorphisms, and also group of contact diffeomorphisms, C0 closed. So therefore, corollary of this, that these two statements, zero-dimensional H principle and one-dimensional H principle, cannot hold simultaneously, because if they were true, then you can disprove this approximation. And hence, here you don't have, so now we have this negative result. But this negative result is in fact a source of some hope, of positive hope, because now it's possibly that one parametric theorem still holds. So that means that what it, in particular what it says. So it says, suppose you take a ball, and on the ball you have a two symplectic structure. For instance, you have a symplectic structure standard near the boundary. And the question, is it isotopic to the standard one or not? So like H principle type result says, well, one parametric that if they formally in the same class, they should be isotopic. And in fact, this is still open in all dimensions. Gromov proved that in dimension 4, this is true up to symplectomorphism. But in dimension 4, unfortunately, we don't know anything about pi 0 of the group of diffeomorphisms of the ball. So up to isotopy, this question is still open, and high dimension is open. And so this is a still completely open problem. So now let's move to contact case. In the contact case, the one parametric H principle failed. So this was already demonstrated first in three-dimensional case by Beneken, who constructed on three-dimensional ball contact structure, which is say in the standard almost contact class, but not isotopic, not even isomorphic to the standard one. And then example of this type were constructed in all dimensions of non-standard contact structure on the balls. So we know that one parametric H principle fails in this case. Yes? So therefore, again, this is a source of some hope, which says that zero parametric H principle could be true. And in fact, turns out that it is true. And this is our recent. It's our recent theorem with Strom Bormann, Amy Murphy, and myself, let's formulate it the following way. So let eta be an almost contact manifold. And suppose that eta restricted to some neighborhood of some.
Before you almost contact was alpha and beta, one form or two form.
Okay, let's take alpha, eta, and call it beta. So suppose you have this almost contact structure, such that this beta on the neighborhood of some closed subset, is a contact structure, is a kind of genuine contact structure. Then beta is homotopic. To a contact structure via almost contact structure fixed on the neighborhood of A. So in particular, if you have near the boundary, you have almost contact structure which is formally extended, then it extends non-formally. So in fact, it turns out that even kind of more true. So there is some kind of one parametric and even two parametric and any parametric H principle also holds if you kind of restrict from all contact structure to certain number of components in the space of contact structure. So like similarly to the three-dimensional case where it was kind of similar to three-dimensional case, turns out that there is some kind of dichotomy of contact structure on any manifold which is called tight and over-twisted. So what is the definition of over-twisted contact structure? So you can define as follows. So let's consider the following map. So let's take a R to n plus 1 and consider the map R to n plus 1 to R to n plus 1, kind of standard map, which I call wrinkle. So it's a map with some kind of standard singularity, which have a fold of singularity and some kind of cusp equator. So it's if you were doing in two-dimensional case, it would look something like this. So you can say this is a map, which is a, so let's say, let's fix. So now I would think about this as a contact space, and I have this standard Darboux coordinate with this form dz minus yi dxi. And let me pick one coordinate. I want to pick yn. And now you consider map, which is an identity. So this map w of, I split all variable except this yn variable. And in all other variable, this map is identity. And with respect to last thing, this is just standard kind of cubic thing. So you write yn cube minus some function alpha of u times yn. So, and you want this function alpha to be positive on some ball. So it's a map non-singular here create two critical points. And then, so you get this picture in high dimension. So you get this thing. So as I said, this map has some sphere of singularity, sphere locus, and let denote by P the ball bounded by the sphere. So now I take. R to n plus one, and subtract this ball, closed ball. And then I say, so I subtract this ball, so I have this open manifold, which is a neighborhood of this thing. And contact structure is called over-twisted if it admits embedding of some open neighborhood of this sphere dB into your manifold. So if this neighborhood, some small neighborhood, some spherical annulus around this a singular sphere can be embedded, then it's called over-twisted. So
how you use W definition?
So I take a W. Ah, so sorry. I didn't say the main thing. Yeah, sorry. Okay, you take this W. And now on R2n, there's a standard symplectic form. So let's call this form lambda. Contact form. Standard contact form lambda. And now you take a W star of lambda. So W star of lambda is degenerate along the singularity, is kind of negative contact form inside and positive contact form outside. So I removed this interior ball, and on the complement on this Rn minus b, W star lambda is a honest, genuine contact form. And so now this is a source of over-twisting neighborhood of the sphere. So if some small neighborhood of the sphere with this contact structure W star lambda can be contactly embedded in your manifold, then manifold is called over-twisted. So in fact, if you consider this concentric sphere sufficiently closed, their image look like this. So image of the sphere. So like you have a family of the sphere, which kind of like as we approaching this singularity, they start to look like this. And in fact, there is a some, for every dimension, there is a some critical smallness of this loop. So in fact, you don't need to embed the whole thing up to the boundary, but sufficiently small. But how small, I cannot say. Okay, and so turns out that over-twisted contact structures satisfy complete H principle. So that means that for over-twisted contact structure, you have a classification, for instance, of this contact structure up to homotopy in the class of almost contact structure is the same as the isotopical classification. For instance, like if you take a sphere S2, I'm sorry for all this. If you take a sphere S2 minus 1, and you want to know how many this over-twisted contact structure up to isotopy exist on the sphere. So this is a precisely question of computation of the homotopy group of. So this homotopy group is a metastable group. And it was computed in 60s this particular case, I think, by Bruno Harris. And so you know precise answer in every dimension. And for instance, we know that if you take a five-dimensional sphere, there's a unique one. So okay. So let me kind of move on. So I'll stop about this contact structure. And let's move to some other example. So I said that like core of symplectic topology is a Lagrangian manifold. And that's like the main rigidity property of Lagrangian manifold. They want to intersect in more points than kind of topology require. So that's all Arnold conjecture about this Lagrangian self-intersection and et cetera. So we can ask the following question. Kind of so this is Lagrangian manifold. And in contact geometry, the corresponding object are Legendrian manifold. And the question about Legendrian manifold, it's not about the embedding, but about the isotopy. So you're asking if you have a two Legendrian manifold, are they isotopic or not? And again, this whole symplectic topology development in contact case provided using holomorphic curves a lot of invariance to distinguish two Legendrian manifold up to Legendrian isotopy. And then it was discovered by Murphy that in fact, in dimension, in contact manifold of dimension greater than 3, there is a class there is a class of Legendre node called loose, such that for this loose Legendre nodes, you have a complete H principle. That means that like formal Legendre isotopy, like forgetting all this, like in the same sense, I don't have really time. I want to say a few more things, so I don't want to go into definition, but formal Legendre isotopy is imply genuine Legendre isotopy. And it's a, I will not give you precise definition, but it's sufficient to say that there is a, you can get from any Legendre node, you can get loose Legendre node by very standard modification in the neighborhood of one point. So you can take any Legendre node and in make some infection, kind of put this virus. And then after that, this Legendre node become viral. Okay, so they become completely flexible. So this was a kind of important step. And then what we did with EMI is we kind of extended the thing to Lagrangian manifold with concave Legendrian ends. So let me explain you what we're talking about. So for me, the starting problem was the following. So suppose you have a ball in R2, suppose you have a ball in R2n. So question, is it possible to find Lagrangian disk in the complement of this ball with Legendrian boundary on the ball? So is there a Lagrangian ball with DB in, with the Lagrangian, is there Lagrangian, sorry, Lagrangian disk, let me say, Lagrangian disk, let's call it delta, Lagrangian disk delta in the complement of the ball, such that D delta inside DB Legendrian. So one can prove using Banneken inequality that in dimension 4 this is impossible, and there are no known example in high dimension. And what turns out that in fact there are plenty of them what we proved, and all of them kind of there is a complete flexibility provided that boundary you make the loose Legendre node. And why I kind of my motivation for this problem that I was interested in problem of topology of so-called polynomially and rationally convex domain. So I don't want to go into the definition, but the point is that if you have a, say, ball and you have this Lagrangian manifold attached with Legendrian boundary, then the neighborhood of this union is, you can get a neighborhood which is so-called rationally convex. In particular, it means that any holomorphic function can be approximated by a rational function there. And so, and this kind of provided complete answer to what the possible topology of rationally and polynomially convex domain in high dimension, in dimension greater than 2 complex. So what we prove? We prove kind of more that for any such Lagrangian manifold with this, what I call concave Legendrian boundary, if boundary is loose, you also have a H principle. So what it implied? That the following, so in, well, I don't want to waste time for handling boards. So. Okay, so what it implied is the following thing. So Gromov proved that in R2n, there are no exact Lagrangian submanifold. So exact meaning that, primitive of symplectic form restricted to the submanifold is exact. Is exact form. So in R2n, the Gromov said the in R2n there are there are no exact Lagrangian submanifold. But what this H principle implies is that there are plenty of Lagrangian submanifold which has a one singular conical point. So you can, if you can make on Lagrangian manifold one conical point, which kind of locally it's automatically cone over Legendrian submanifold, then you have a complete kind of freedom of constructing such thing. And this, this also allowed to do the following thing, that when you take this point, and when you if you study the structure near the point and the Legendre node, it's very possible for some of this, if topology allow, to resolve it just with one extra intersection point. So this immediately provided kind of another counterexample to the whole this line of problems about the minimal number of Lagrangian self-intersection. So there is a this is our, by the way, this is about the self-intersection, our joint work with Murphy and also with Ekholm and Smith. So so along with this Arnold conjecture about minimal number of intersections of two manifolds, there was I don't know if Arnold ever wrote it in writing, but certainly he was talking about this problems about what is the minimal number of self-intersection of exact Lagrangian submanifold R2n. For instance, there was a kind of conjecture that you have a torus and you have exact Lagrangian immersion, then of n-dimensional torus to R2n, then it should have 2 to the n minus 1 points. So essentially half of the rank of homology, kind of the natural conjecture. And this show you that this is completely wrong, because you can kind of essentially one extra point, extra intersection point, allow you to do everything. So for instance, the corollary, I will not give you precise definition, precise formulation, but for instance, the corollary that if you have any three-dimensional manifold, you can always find Lagrangian immersion to R6 with exactly one self-intersection point. So let me kind of finish with so this is a kind of essentially all what I know mostly about what I can prove. But let me tell you some kind of conjecture which I cannot prove, but I kind of in the same spirit, I think they should be true. So one is a question about construction of symplectic structures. So this is already conjectured. So kind of construction of symplectic structure. So symplectic manifold with concave over twisted contact boundary satisfy H principle. In particular, this would imply that given symplectic manifold which is formally symplectic, well, maybe you cannot construct symplectic structure, or maybe even you can, but we don't know this, but at least you can always construct symplectic structure with one singular point. And near the singular point, it would look like cone over some overstwisted S4. So I'm pretty sure that this is true in four dimensions. Kind of I will have some sketch how to prove, but I think this is true in all dimensions as well. So the second question is the following. Okay, I would also conjecture. Well, this is not so original, because many people conjecture this. But I would also conjecture that, in fact, even construction of symplectic structure, so extension problem for symplectic structure have extra abstractions. But construction of symplectic structure on closed manifold is, in fact, I think, have no abstraction in dimension greater than 4, and even in dimension 4, it also should not have an abstraction beyond some kind of obvious counterexample. So now another kind of type of conjecture. So okay, so construction of symplectic structure. On closed manifold. And then the last one which I want to mention are bounds, and okay, let me call it anti-Arnold conjecture. Okay, so Arnold conjecture about, like classical Arnold conjecture about intersection of, deformation of zero section in cotangent bundle. What is the Arnold conjecture? Not clear. So you can say that Arnold conjecture is a statement about bound in terms of Frank homology. You can say it's a statement in bound terms of bound of the minimum number of critical point of function. And certainly it was expressed in this extreme form many times. So kind of what I want to say is that on the other hand, if you look at the holomorphic curve method, then it's completely kind of inconceivable that holomorphic curve method can prove anything beyond bound on stable Morse number. So like if you have a manifold, there is a stable Morse number, that's a number of minimal number of critical points after quadratic stabilization of this function. And this bound is proven for this particular problem. And I think this is at least in sufficiently high dimension, is exact bound. So should be some kind of H principle that if you have some example when this stable number is less, and such example, for instance, were constructed by Damian, then we, in this case, should be possible to, in fact, remove extra intersection point from zero section. Okay, thank you.
So you said that your principle is that if something cannot be proved by holomorphic curves, then it shouldn't exist, or something.
Or it should exist. Holomorphic curve essentially proving you something. First of all, I'm trying to stay away from dimension 4. Dimension 4, kind of, there's a special story, but maybe also it's subject to H principle, subject to the same principle, but with their holomorphic curve much more powerful, they kind of imply.
But for the boy with standard boundary,
yes.
You think that it's not possible to say anything for a particular reason or because it's...
No. But that I'm extremely afraid to say. So I'm not conjecturing this. So I don't think there is enough evidence yet that this question whether there is a standard symplectic structure, non-standard symplectic structure on both standard with the boundary, whether we explored all possibilities of holomorphic curve. It seems to be very difficult to construct such something which holomorphic curve would distinguish. But maybe there is a, we're just not clever enough. But still, I would maintain if somehow we kind of exhaust all holomorphic methods, then probably it exists.
There are no more questions? Yes.
Oh. So about this statement that in symplectic world anything other not forbidden by holomorphic curve is possible, do you think that at some point one can cook up rigorous conjecture which makes this rigorous rather than just as a principle?
Okay, how can I say? Okay, I cannot make it rigorous at the moment, so maybe somebody will be able to do it.